1990 to 2000, and we're still very good colleagues and have worked on a paper together quite recently on design research. But since that time, I've learned from David Button, I explained I haven't actually worked at the classroom level for 12 or 13 years. I'm focusing more on teachers' learning, and then more recently, quite consciously and explicitly, on what it takes to improve the quality of math teaching on a large scale. And if that's of interest, I'm fully invited to come. So we're about to find out if that's of interest or not. I've added a second author. I wish I'd included her when I sent in the original abstract. Carol Jackson said all about it later, but she's kind of my main thinking partner as we work through a lot of these issues. We've been at this, just starting our seventh year of this project right now. By the way, I'm happy to take any questions or whatever we go along, particularly if there's any issues of clarification. I might be staring in the wrong direction, so shout or David will point people out. What I intend to do is first, just very briefly at the beginning, give us a quick overview of what I see as progress of research in math education over the last 25 years or so. I think we've made really significant progress. The point I'm going to make is, despite that progress, it has very, very, very little impact or influence on what goes on in most math classrooms in the US right now. And against that background, I talked about the work in which I've been involved. It's a longitudinal project that involves partnerships with districts, initially with four districts, 2007 to 2011, and carrying on with two of those districts, but collaborating even more closely. So that's the game plan. And if I think back, not to the years I've been in business, but at least there's an era back in the day that David was talking about earlier, and I look over the progress, and I know a lot of this applies to science education as well. We've delineated pretty detailed learning trajectories, trajectories of students learning in a range of mathematical domains. That shift came about as people moved from sort of conducting interview studies to actually working in classrooms to try and figure out how to support kids' learning. I think a lot of the research that was going on at Boulder Institute at the same time feeds into that. There, the phrase of developmental research, meaning research and instructional development, where it's the idea or the understanding that the trajectories or the progressions we are identifying are tied to the means of supporting, including but not limited to curriculum materials. That's informed the development of a number of commercially published instructional materials, obviously in math and context, but a number of others as well. I think a very significant progress. Also, this country is consensus in the research community on broadly what high-quality math teaching looks like, organized what capitalizes on research and learning, involving using pretty conceptually demanding or rigorous tasks much of the time. Kids work on the task individually or in groups, and in the whole class discussion, tremendous amount of research identifying aspects of productive whole class discussions. For example, teachers pressing, eliciting kids' thinking, pressing kids to explain and justify their reasoning, making connections between different solutions, making connections with big mathematical ideas, and so on. So we have a pretty detailed picture of high-quality math instruction, where each aspect is justified in terms of student learning opportunities. And I would say, over the last 10 years, research on math teaching and math teachers' learning, professional development in math has really come of age. Two aspects of that, clearly we've identified some aspects of important aspects of teacher knowledge, such as mathematical knowledge of teaching. I noticed, however, that compared with when David and I were in that center together, a lot of focus on teachers understanding the students' mathematical thinking. That seems to have fallen by the wayside, which is very disappointing. I think many of us who work with teachers understand it also, understand how kids' mathematical reasoning develops in particular content domains is also important. In addition, another development is the identification of specific high-level instruction and practice that support all students' learning. I think the key thing here is specific instruction practices, meaning not just broad descriptions of what high-quality instruction looks like, Now, I want to give an example from our own work, and I mentioned the second one first, which is from Mary Haystein, Peg Smith, and so on at the University of Pittsburgh around planning conducted for class discussions. In our own work, we focused on how teachers might introduce or launch complex, relatively demanding tasks. And so here's an example. I'm going to do this very quickly. Sadly, not from math and context, from the curriculum that three of our four partner districts use, but clearly a context problem. In this case, it's a story about a teacher just customized instructing his school, having a dance marathon to raise money, have a DJ at an upcoming dance, the Valentine's dance, and the reason having the marathon is to raise money. It talks about three different plans. One student is getting $3 an hour, pledges $3 an hour, another student is getting $8 up front plus 50 cents an hour. The important thing to know is that this is the first time these students have encountered a linear relation with a non-zero intersect. Think about how the teacher might introduce that if the class is very diverse, 25 of the students' first languages in English, and so forth. What are some of the things that the teacher needs to plan for and think about so that the kids can engage with the mathematics, engage significantly in the task, not necessarily solve it correctly? That's what the whole class discussions were actually engaging. Well, clearly, in this group, a number of kids won't know what a dance is. So you actually have to develop the situation. Secondly, we also think it's important to focus on key mathematical ideas. Again, not do the math, but in this case, it seems pretty essential to make sure all the kids have an image of over time money accumulating as time passes. That image is also going to get mathematized as they work on the problem. And then clearly, we have to attend to issues of language. And in this case, for example, the word pledge. Is it likely that many of the students won't understand that? Well, yes, it is. So these are the sort of things that the teacher, in 8 to 10 minutes, needs to address in an introductory discussion, drawing out to the other kids before they engage. And this would be an example of a specific instruction and practice where we can begin to highlight particular issues the teacher needs to identify, think about in relation to their students, and then figure out how to work through before the kids begin working on the task. I want to mention this advance in focusing on specific tasks because it relates to the second advance, which is researching math teachers learn. In the last 5 years in particular, the people I'm thinking of, in case you're familiar with names, people like Magdalene Lambert, Aidan Frank, and Hazard, but particularly Pam Grossman's introduced a distinction in teacher development between what she calls pedagogies of investigation and pedagogies of math. Some of you may be familiar with this. Briefly, much of what we do in teacher development involves pedagogies for investigation. We have teachers look and analyze videotapes of kids solving tasks, classrooms, for example. We have them look at the sets of student work, understand kids' thinking, to order the solutions, and these are most sophisticated, and so on and so forth. This is important, but it's analysis, to analyze the teacher. In addition, enacting means actually practicing specific instructional practices with the support of somebody who's pretty accomplished. And it might be a graduated series of increasingly complex situations. So for example, if it's a group of seventh grade teachers at a school working with a math coach, the other teachers might initially play the students along with the coach as one of the teacher's practices for a particular later, the teachers might do it in their classrooms, or they might do it with a small group of students, and then report back. So it's actually identifying practices that are specific, so teachers can actually practice when they get better at it. And a lot of where this came from Rosa's work was, she studied other human professions and looked at the induction process, a whole range of them, and found that almost invariably they have identified specific literally practice and get feedback from their school. Understanding this isn't a process of proceduralization, but at least it identifies the routine aspects so that the teachers can focus using their knowledge and wisdom on the reports that really matter, like what do my kids know better about the app, and judgment about whether they need to spend time developing apps in the area or not. So this is a big advantage. The current state of play, that work is still typically being done by researchers working with relatively small groups of teachers, often pre-service teachers. So the question, from our point of view, if we look at what has been gained in terms of our knowledge over the last 25 years, how can we capitalize on that knowledge to support improvements in the quality of math teaching at large scale? And that's the question I and my colleagues are interested in, have been. And when we talk about scale in the context of the US, from our point of view, the largest administrative unit that makes sense to deal with is a large open district. It helps to be humble when you address issues of scale. I think if you look back at the history of reform efforts in all subject matter areas, it's largely one failure, right? Richard Elmore, a research in policy and leadership, summed it up this way. Closer instruction innovation gets to what takes place between teachers and students in classrooms, the less likely it is to be implemented and sustained on a large scale. He's just summarizing the track record of a 100-year period. I can also quote Larry Kuhn, historian of education, who says, on the surface, in education, it's one of continual change and innovation and churn and all the policies coming into the district. But when you go down to the classroom, no change. It's like, metaphor he used, it's like an ocean with a hurricane. On the surface, the waves are crashing everywhere. The bottom of the classroom is tranquil. So this is a major challenge. This is not easy stuff. And so we do, I hope, have a fair degree of humility as we approach this issue. The first step for us is to clarify the nature of the problem. Clearly, it's a problem of supporting the learning of groups of teachers. That is necessary, essential, critical. I don't want to be misunderstood. Curriculum materials are critical, professional development is essential, but they're absolutely not sufficient. If that's all in the arsenal, that's the only tools we've got to toast. Why? We know for sure that professional development, the influence of professional development on classroom instruction is mediated by the school and district context and the teacher's work. A simple illustration. Teachers are, for example, have a series of professional development sessions that focus on enacting a particular RME instruction process. At the same time, their principal is of leadership workshops on what to look for in classrooms. The teachers come back with principles of communicating contradictory or expectations to adults. I see a number of people nodding. This is a relatively familiar story. The principal and the expectations he or she is communicating with just one aspect of the school setting. So it's these sorts of things we're interested in. But in another way, from our point of view, the challenge is you have to support teachers' learning, but also supporting the organization, school, and district context in which teachers work. So that those contexts are called their press for the ongoing improvement of their instructional practices. That's going to implicate the practices of math coaches, school leaders, you, and the district leaders. So from our point of view, it's a problem of both organization and teacher learning. I want to stress both. It's not either or. It's not, hey, focus on teacher learning, got it all wrong, it's all about organizations. No, it's about both together. If we just focus on the organization without focusing on teachers, we also need to focus. Now, that's kind of the preamble or the sort of introduction. I hope it provides some kind of context for what we've been up to. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the first phase of our work, where we established a partnership with four urban districts that serve 360,000 students. So these were fair-sized districts. And our focus was very specifically on middle grade spread mathematics. So we weren't concerned with K-12, just limited it to middle grade spread 6 to 8. Obviously, when we use the term like urban, it's a code word for lots of things, some of which I just listed up here. I suspect most of you are familiar with them, the high kitchen turnover, high budgets, and so on and so forth. In the context of no child left behind and high states of disability, Richard Elmore observed that most schools and districts are pretty clueless about how to respond to those pressures. And I suspect some of you also know what we're talking about. Either figuring out how to teach for a pretty abysmal low-level tests, or even worse, how to gain a new system. We worked hard to try and recruit from this small minority of districts that had reasonably well-worked out strategies in those terms. In particular, we wanted to recruit districts who were attempting to improve the quality of the instruction. That was their response. So they were aiming high, as I'll clarify in a minute, and they also had worked out sets of improvement strategies. They're investing in professional development of teachers. They also understood that school leadership was important and also worked with their principals, for example. So there were two districts, urban districts, in every respect, except at least the time we started with quality of leadership. They've articulated relatively ambitious goals for students' math learning. I remember one of the districts, when we first started, they had a two-day session, senior district leaders with every principal. So it's 240 schools, 240 principals. They were working them over to try and communicate the point that passing the state test was adequate. Why was it adequate? Because if kids were generally proficient, they probably couldn't get to university with such a low-level test. And if they did, they'd fail when they got there. So they were again stressing, trying to communicate this point about keeping time. So these are pretty courageous people. And they are just overcoming themselves with the state assessments. They go and give the grade. And they have, in some fashion, articulated, or at least people in the district have articulated, a vision for what should be happening in classrooms to enable students to achieve those relatively ambitious goals. Involving building on kids' thinking to achieve a mathematical agenda. So these aren't typical districts. You might gather that not all of these districts, none of them are in my home state, as you can see. So we will work remotely to get our plans and go to these places. When we were preparing to do this work, we developed instruments, but we also developed an initial set of conjectures about where we might take support for instruction improvement. We don't need to go through the laundry list. I just wanted to clarify ranges from curriculum materials and associated resources up to district leadership. So we're taking a pretty broad view of what might be involved here. And our plan working with these districts was to test, revise, and elaborate our initial conjectures. So we developed initial conjectures with the expectation that it would prove limited, inadequate, or whatever. And in working with district, refine, figure out what we're going on this time. Long-term goals develop what we would call the theory of action instruction in mathematics at scale. Where a theory of action comprises a set of policies or strategies for supporting and holding others accountable, together with the rationale that explains why those strategies might be expected to support teachers and others' learning. So that's what we aim for. How did we go about this? How did we work with these districts? Well, we recruited, in consultation with district leaders, we recruited between 6 and 10 middle school grade schools in each district, randomly selected 30 middle grade math teachers across those schools, recruited the math coaches to serve those schools, the school leaders, the principal, and sometimes an assistant principal who had responsibility for the mathematics, and then district leaders across 5 units that have a stake in what happens in math classrooms. Clearly, math curriculum instruction, but also ELL, English language learning, for example, special education have a stake in what happens in math classrooms and so on. So it turned out to be about 50 people in each district, about 200 folks altogether. And how do we actually work with district in this sort of testing, revising our conjectures process? First step we did each year in each district, so we were doing this sort of, in parallel in each of the 4 districts. We went to each district in the fall, and we interviewed our 10 senior district leaders. Our reason for doing so was to understand what their plans or strategies for improving Mac this year. Now we actually write this up in 3 or 4 pages and say, here's what we see as your 4 major plans. One of them might be professional development for school leaders to improve the quality of the feedback they provide to teachers. The second one might be coaching. The third one might be work they're doing to improve the quality of teacher collaborative time. Those sorts of things. And it ranges between 3 and 5 or 6, depending on district major plans or strategies. And so if we get this right, then between January and March, which is a big data collection, the reason for this was to try and document how the district strategy is actually playing out on the ground in schools and in classrooms. So first of all, in January, we spent a week in each district interviewing 200 folks about an hour long interviews. And there's a different protocol. Basically, what we're interested in for each of our participants was to understand the settings in which they work, what they're accountable for, to whom they're accountable, what supports they had to improve their practice, both formal and informal supports, what tools they use as part of their practice, including in the case of teachers, what curriculum materials or other instructional resources, so on and so forth. In addition, we had parallel surveys online, and then I'll just go quickly through the rest of the data we collected each year. We video recorded 2 consecutive lessons in each of the 120 teachers' classrooms using a particular protocol developed in the University of Pittsburgh, the I2A Instructional Quality Assessment. The coaches and the teachers took the mathematical knowledge for instrument, mathematical knowledge for teaching instrument developed by Deborah Ball and Kessler and Company at the University of Michigan. We recorded select teacher professional development. We also got after the first year, the teachers would record teacher collaborative meetings at audio recordings and tapes. We also are interested in teaching networks. In addition to our 120 teachers, there were 300 teachers in our public schools, math teachers, and they completed the surveys of their teacher professional networks. And we had access to the districts to achieve Michigan concrete low-level tests. So a lot of this stuff they use in retrospective analysis that we began in year 3 of our work. For the most part today, for the rest of this, I'm going to be focusing just on the annual cycles, okay? The understanding is also going to be seen through retrospective analysis. Having collected the data, what we did, we send out the interviews to be transcribed by a service, and then analyze them by name so that we could develop detailed reports for each district about how each of their major plans or strategies is playing out. And typically, gaps between what they hoped for or what happened explain why these differences were occurring and make actionable recommendations for districts about how they might improve or adjust their strategies more effectively. Then we would go back to the district and send that in. A week later, we would go back and meet with senior district leaders to talk through our report and its implications and their plans for coming to school year. So our week one performance and intervention is pretty limited plan. We send in 1 15 school space document to them, and we have a 2-hour meeting. We can then go back before October and look at what are their plans for the coming year and track to what extent they were attempting to act on our feedback recommendations. And I remember the first year we did this, we were actually kind of shocked at the extent to which they did attempt, and I stress the word attempt, did attempt to act on those recommendations. And we think the reason is we were the only community down. We could actually give pretty targeted feedback specific to their practice and their instructions. One of the keys is the word partnership, became a partnership. And I think one of the things that was important, we organized what we did within the framework of the district's goals. Now we worked around group districts where there was some compatibility in the level of those goals. So that's the overview. I need to mention that. Actually, a few mates helped me out with this. Tom Smith is a colleague, he's a faculty member. policy and leadership. So we attempted to work across those two fields. Kara Jackson started out as a postdoc in the first place. She's now a PI at the Faculty University of Washington. Erin Hickman's our project manager. Yolanda Holm focuses on teachers, level online. And Ken Frank focuses on teacher professional networks. And then a bunch of two postdocs at the top there and doctoral students across three campuses in math education, policy and leadership. So that's the current group. Now what I want to do is go through what we see as key aspects of the current iteration, understanding the vision, moment to revision of the current iteration of our theory of action. And rather than go through the list of components, I'll just go through them quickly one at a time. There's five major components. The first, which is a coherent construction system, in itself has four elements. You can see them up there. Things like curriculum materials, teacher professional development, assessment, traditional support, instructing students. The operative term here is coherent instruction system. In other words, research, we know from people like Tom Grant and Fred Newman, that the school systems and schools that are like that actually make progress, these elements are coordinated or connected deliberately so they fit together. I'll try and illustrate what that means. I would say, by and large, that rarely happens. So these are often pointing in separate directions. They cover a research and policy pretty well. We said most of these districts are really struggling to develop systems without knowing what one is. They have to work in a different way of that. Okay? So this is what we tweak other people's work to. So it's specific to ambitious goals for math instruction, which I think includes RME as well. So the first aspect, explicit goals for students learn. Clearly that's important in the vision of what high-quality math instruction looks like. We now push harder to try and identify within that vision those small number, stress small number, but high-leverage practices, high-leverage meaning can be justified. There's reason to believe that sexually or empirically really make a difference to kids' math learning. Instructional materials, I want to stress again, necessary but not sufficient. They require significant teacher learning. The sorts of materials our districts adopt, and I know for sure, materials developed that are consistent with the RME philosophy. Compared with most US teachers' instructional practices, this is very profound change. It involves a significant reorganization of current practice. It involves rethinking issues of content. It involves rethinking how kids learn and how that learning can be supported. So that's the first aspect. Teacher professional development. We know several things from just the broad literature already. The importance is sustained over time. It's not one-shot workshops. It involves the same group of teachers working together. And actually become a group, if not a community. It's organized around very specific materials teachers are using in their classroom. It's close to practice. For this, we have to add a couple of things. It should focus on a small number of specific practices. It should involve both pedagogies of investigation and pedagogies of anatomy. So in other words, the quest here is to make the professional development all teachers receive as close to practice as humanly possible. And it should be coordinated across context. So if teachers are, for example, working on planning and orchestrating whole class discussions and pull out professional development, that work can be carried on in teacher collaborative time. And a coach who works with individual teachers in their classrooms might also have that focus. So there's consistency in the supports for teachers to improve their practice. Third, assessments and informed instruction. Clearly not my strong suit of focus, but we will report. You'll be obviously would like an pivotal, I mean primarily district developed assessments should be aligned to the learning goals. Typically they're not. They're aligned with state assessments that at least until recently have been pretty low level. Ideally they should inform the ongoing improve construction. Typically, they don't, they're summative, and they're developed to predict which piece is going to fail on the state assessment so they can receive remediation to get them over the line. We know there's work going on, I think, with GeoCon 3 and others building on that work on learning trajectories and learning progressions to develop assessment systems that can help inform teachers in supporting kids' progress along the learning trajectory. I think that's a way off, but that's the direction ideally work on assessment might move. The last, which I anticipated putting up here when we started, it was not on our scope, additional support for struggling students. We did a literature research on what it work, what research has been conducted on additional support for struggling students when the focus is on ambitious goals, and we can find nothing whatsoever. If people know stuff, I would love to hear about it because we couldn't find it. We actually phoned up some curriculum developers, developers of good curriculum. I know some of these people and asked this question. And they invariably said, that's amazing. Nobody's ever asked us that question. Yet, when you work in schools and districts, as I know a number of you do, this is a very, very real question. I see some people wondering. It's sensible to take the position that in any instructional regime, including those we like, and I like RME, there will be kids, there are kids for certain, who are not being served adequately. So what is going to be the additional support? What typically happens right now, I think you know, is it's either tutoring, or it's second math classes, double dipping, and so on and so forth. In our experience, districts are left to their own devices. Those second math classes are procedural competencies based on the assumption that kids don't know the basics yet, rather than preparing kids to be successful in the context of mainstream math instruction. So the goal from our point of view of the additional course is to enable the kids to be successful in those mainstream instructions. We have exactly the same goal as all the students, but just some kids need more support. Again, if anybody's thinking about a dissertation, wow, that's a wide open an area where the need is enormous in our future. Very important from the point of view of equity. So, quick overview of what we see. Provisional could change the key aspects of a coherent instruction system. I hope you see how we think about the bits fitting together. Earlier I said it's issue of organizational learning as well as teacher learning. We see a district developing a coherent instructional system as a key step in the district's learning as an organization. Yes, it involves the learning of a number of people who coordinate their activities to develop a system. That's what we mean by organizational learning, and part of our job is to try and work on this to at least identify some goals for organization. So that's component one. Component two, very important, teacher collaborative. A very, very common type of strategy. Many districts across the country are allocating time for teacher collaborative. Right. Ideally, obviously, it should be during the school day. Also, we want to note that the development of a coherent instruction system and it's possible to have teacher collaboration. If teachers are using the same instructional materials across a number of schools, if they're initially involved in some of the same district professional developments ongoing, focusing on the same practices, that can at least foster the development of an initial common language to talk about instruction and to develop a program that teacher collaborative work. However, what we typically see for the first 4 years, we just relied on our interviews to find out what was happening in the teacher collaborative environment. And our sense from that was most of the time this is not good. For the last 2 years, our colleague Patrick Horn has been videoing the teacher collaborative environment in 3 schools in the district. He shows because the thought was a good chance it could be productive. Occasionally it is in some schools, but most of the time it isn't. You may have seen this, I'm sure many of you have. Here's the sort of overview. Teachers come. come together to decide how to divide up the planning board. You know, you can take 5.1 and 5.2, 5.3, so on, so on, so off they go. That's it. Clearly, we want to be productive. Here's a finding from our work that we've observed. This comes from our network group. And the question we're asking is, what does it take for teacher development to go? We found that teachers have interaction with peers who've already developed more accomplished practices, that's associated with development of one practice. In other words, it's pointing to the fact that expertise, working with colleagues who are more sophisticated, is important. The second finding, the level of sophistication of the instructional practices of the most accomplished teacher in a school is associated with overall improvement in the quality of instruction in that school. So, in other words, both rich and rich. The sort of goal, the point of the realm here is instruction expertise. And some of our districts, that's a very short supply. So, what does that mean for teacher development? Right now, our current theory of action would say it's imperative that at least one participant has already developed accomplished practices. And that person is constituted as the, or those people are constituted leaders in the teaching. To make this as graphic as possible, one of our districts, when we began working, had an initiative teaching development. They actually had arranged it that teachers K through 12 had one release period every day to work. That cost them $14 million a week. Weekly had no impact of that. On quality instruction. The reason is because in most of those groups there was no expert, nobody who was already accomplished. In other words, if folks were, if you think about this analogy with the kids working together, it's as if you give kids some rich problems and just leave them to them and come back and expect them to have a pretty sophisticated concept of rational number. Exactly the same thing. The role of somebody who's already accomplished to press and to lead is essential. So what should those leaders be doing? They can influence the type of activities that the teachers engage. And we make a crude dichotomy between what we call low depth and high depth activities. Low depth is talking about pacing, where are you in the curriculum, or like pacing, sharing instructional materials. Clearly that can be useful. But by itself, it's not going to support teachers developing efficiency. Whereas high depth activities include but are not limited to doing math problems together once they're confusing the kids and identifying central mathematical ideas. Analyzing student work to understand the different ways the kids solve problems, for example. In addition to influencing the types of activities kids do, the leader can also influence how those activities are enacted. By pressing on key issues. For example, if they're working on a math problem, we can press on teachers explicitly, not just to do the problem, but to identify what are the central of the mathematical ideas. What, if you do this with kids, what pieces of math can you get on the table by doing what the kids do? If you're working through a set of kids' solutions, trying to figure out how kids did a problem, they might then ask, okay, so let's step back. Which of these solutions do you want to include in a whole class discussion? Why? Where the justification has to be with an eye towards whatever mathematical horizon where we want to go. We've got a mathematical agenda we're trying to achieve by building on what it is. How about good instructional materials, including the RME materials, designed to do is to give the teacher a set of student solutions to build from to achieve the mathematical agenda. This type of work is designed to support kids in capitalizing on the possibilities of such materials. So that's kind of talking through teacher collaborative time, stressing the importance of expertise. I'll just tell you, there's so much rhetoric when we began this around teacher collaborative time, not just in our district, nationally, as if it's a silver bullet. I was very skeptical, but I worked very hard to sustain my business. belief that if you put groups of teachers together in rooms, wonderful things will happen. We have pretty compelling evidence it doesn't. It has this achievement to stand up productive teaching practices. One of our districts has 8% of teachers who have relatively accomplished practices. One teacher in 12. What do you do in such situations to support teachers' learning if you want a productive teaching development program? You have, in a lot of these schools, you have to bring in or close the right expertise, which is actually absolutely critical. And here we see a vital role of mathematics coaches. I'm going to use the word coach, but I mean specifically mathematics coaches, content expertise. Now, I think we're all familiar with the rationale for coaches, which on the surface is pretty compelling. They propose to develop relatively sophisticated practices and can potentially be more productive others. In other words, they can be the experts, they can co-participate with teachers in activities of social practice. What's our current position? Given most of the three of our four original districts deserve the shortage of expertise, we recommended that districts give priority to coaches in order to be groups of teachers, because they can potentially support all, say, the 7th grade or the 8th grade teachers learning in a particular group, and we can suggest particular ways of organizing that. And then, as necessary, as time allows, work with individual teachers in their classrooms. I want to stress again this linkage across contexts, where the coaches are focusing on the same practices in their work with groups of teachers and then they follow up with individual teachers in their classrooms. I've already said a lot about working with groups right now, referring to the importance of expertise and teaching management. But let's just say something about working with individual teachers. Part of the trouble with doing this type of work is the further you get away from the classroom, the less research there is about this. So when we get to content-focused coaching, there's almost no research. What we have to do is extrapolate and work in math teacher education, where, for example, researchers can work with groups of teachers. And that's the sort of stuff we have to draw. So I want to put my hand up and say there's some sort of projection here. So this, from now on, I'm reporting where we are currently placing our bets and the reason why we're making those bets. Typically, what our coaches left their own devices do is observe classrooms and give feedback to teachers. That can be useful. But in and of itself, if we look at the literature in math teacher development, but also on development of professional practices, complex practices more generally, that's a very weak mechanism. We also see value initially if teachers are working on a particular practice, sometimes for modeling, for coach modeling, but it appears to be essential that there's an initial discussion of what the teachers can focus on, they don't just observe. Aspect of instruction, and then there's a deep reading afterwards. You also potentially see value in co-teaching as the teacher is working on developing that practice, where in effect the coach is scaffolding the teacher. We can see a role for observing and giving feedback later when the teacher is attempting to choose the practice. So it's a matter of arming and testing conjectures about when particular types of activities might be appropriate. Tailoring what the coach does to those activities. We're also interested in what the coaches actually need to know to do this work. The literature tells us nothing, except they need to be accomplished teachers, we agree, they need to have relatively deep content understanding. What else? We're playing around with this notion of a professional division coaching. So imagine this, the coach goes into the classroom to observe a teacher. What might we hope the coach would see? Well, we hope the coach, I think, would have a pretty sophisticated vision of what kind of instruction looks like. And they can, as they understand what this teacher's doing, they can look at it in relation to that very sophisticated vision. We might also hope the coach has got a sense of the trajectory of the teacher's learning and can see that teacher not as deficit with respect to the goal, but in terms of the point on which to build And I would say the sacrificial offering of this one, the notion of professional vision for coaching. But notice, because we're having trouble specifying what coaches need to know, those would be the goal of the coaches' work. So that's the current state of play. Again, an area of your point of developing a dissertation is an area of life. The fourth component, the actual research phase, is even worse, because there's no consensus on what school leaders need to know and be able to do to instruct effective instruction leaders on that if you're aiming at ambitious goals. There's two broad positions, as we see it. One is they need to know general characteristics of high quality instruction that are not specific to content. Just, you know, like teachers should be rigorous tasks, whether it's social studies, English language arts, and second position is the principles or systems need deep mathematical knowledge to teach it. They need to have an understanding of students' mathematical learning. They need to understand what high-quality math instruction looks like. And they need to understand teacher learning. Now, the only problem with that is I couldn't do that across all the competencies. I could put it in math, but social studies is left beyond me. So this is a really high bar. It's almost as if principles would be coaching. Here's an initial finding. One of the things we do in our interviews for all participants, teachers, the principals, district leaders, and coaches as well, is we try to get their vision of high quality math instruction. And we ask them, suppose you are going into a math classroom and you can stay as long as you want, what would you look for to know this high quality math instruction? And then we have a series of probes. Now we ask them specifically about the nature of the instruction task that gets high quality math instruction. We ask them, whole class discussion, if they say yes, we probe them around who's doing the talking, what are they talking about, and we press them on what specifically is the teacher doing in various spaces of this. And we've got pretty good coding in this and get high reliability. What we found, we initially in this first phase, we had 30 principals, 27 had what we call a form view of high quality math teaching. In other words, they could say, yeah, there should be a whole class math. They were able to differentiate between a strong and a balanced whole class discussion. They could see the forms that whole class members would tick, as if you have a checklist, but they couldn't look at it in terms of the characteristics of the aspects of whole class discussion that support students' mathematical learning. Now, we just mentioned that kind of consistent with our analysis of the feedback teachers reported getting. Those principals, the three of the four districts, had extensive teacher, school leader professional development 2 years ago, but it focused on general content and independent characteristics. What we think is going on, of course, is those general principles are really abstract. And they're too abstract for principals, I think, for anybody else. It took me a while to connect the book on to concrete instructional practices. And I would just mention one thing that encompasses those who have over the years is the phrase I now use is sort of fighting our way up and the academic value and the abstraction of the students. What's missing in all of this work in most of the literature is the specification of concrete practices. On the other hand, the other position that the principals need to act essentially as math coaches is literally, if it's feasible, beyond the capacity of most districts, including ours, to support. So what's our position right now? We will talk about a distribution of instructional leadership at the school level. That the coaches and perhaps the district math specialists are primarily responsible for supporting teachers' learning, while school leaders are primarily responsible for pressing and holding teachers accountable for developing instructional practices. So the issue is that feasible? It would involve principals being able to differentiate between strong and weak enactments of, say, RME activities. Is that needed? We're putting our bets on three many types of principal practice. One is observing and giving feedback. Notice this again would require the principles to make that distinction between high and low quality elements of particular practices. And it would involve in providing feedback that communicates those expectations. We've done an initial pilot PD in two of our districts so far, and we've had some encouraging signs, but this is not easy stuff. What we try to do is to restrict ourselves to what's feasible for most districts. We typically have one principal meeting a month, and we try to get the agenda for 2 to 3 hours. So is it feasible over a relatively short contact time with extremely busy principals to support them in coming to make these distinctions, and also between high and low level construction tasks? We think it might be, but we're still continuing to work on designs on that line. A second practice is principals or assistant principal participating in teacher collaborative time. Why? It signals the importance of that work, and it's a big investment for the district. It's a way of holding teachers accountable for how they use the time, but perhaps most importantly, it's also an opportunity or an occasion or a context that school leaders work. In other words, most of them are not math specialists. They would earn their not to take over the meeting. That happens, and it's usually not productive. They're in there as participants, and what they learn then or in their classroom observations. The third practice is collaborating with the coach, the math coach who serves the school. Very few findings in this area around coaching. There is one. Three different studies pointing in the same direction. Namely, the effectiveness of these school-based math coaches depends critically on the nature of the relationship with the principal. Does the principal understand that some detail of the coach is doing and should be doing? Not just are they here to support the teachers, but they're here, they're leading our teacher collaborative groups, they're focusing on math and student thinking, they're working with teachers to make their leaps at that point. They understand that. We recommend that the school leader meet with the coach regularly, ideally weekly, for say half an hour, and they don't just sit there talking about who's on the case and who isn't. They're talking about specific aspects of individual teachers' instructional practices. They've both been in the same classrooms, right? And then they're using that information to plan how to support instructional improvement. So if we put those pieces together, we talk about instructional leadership as a key that has the following characteristics. So I have no idea how to do it. But the purpose of there, we just have to start there and start. They attend teacher collaborative time. That's an opportunity for their learning. They become familiar with particular practices teachers work with. Perhaps have a launch, instructional challenging task for students to engage. That then orients what they look for in the classroom. Hopefully they're better positioned to make sense of what's going on and to provide feedback that communicates expectations, at least around that particular practice. Because they've observed and looked up, they're then in a better position to, when they meet with the coach, have conversations about specific aspects of instruction. You know, this teacher's classroom, what they put the launch of the plan versus that teacher's classroom. And against that background, the coach and the school leader can then talk through what the agenda might be for the teacher collaborative time. What are some of the key issues to focus on to support teachers' learning? So that's what we see currently in the second short-term school leadership team in the world of our students. So, we're out to school leadership right now. We focus on, obviously, on supporting media teachers, PD, curriculum. We also focus on other key personnel, school leaders, and coaches. And now step back on further to the district's central office. And I like to think of this as going from hell to yonder, if there's literally nothing relevant we can build on. I think that one thing that came out just within the last year from Merrill Deponic, looking at some specific practices of folks who go out So a big aspect of the work of distribution should be the support development, for example, that school instruction and leadership to develop, to put in place a coherent instruction system at the district level and so on. Now clearly, I think everybody knows district central offices are composed of separate units. In most cases, the two that really matter are curriculum instruction, where the amount of people are housed who have a lot to do with developing frameworks in mathematics, for doing math PD, and leadership. These are the folks who hire principals, who move principals around, who provide principal PD, who hold principals account. We think we can trace this down to the classroom. It's crucial that leaders in these different units frame the problem of improving students' math instruction or math learning in compatible ways. Now, I want to give an example. A distinction we found useful between what we call instructional improvement and instructional management. Instructional improvement is what I've been planning my track about for the last hour. It's sort of building the capacity, helping people get better to improve their practice. Instructional management is about making the best of what you expect. So a classic instructional management strategy would be to look through your test data to see, hey, our seventh graders didn't do very well on this set of standards, but this teaches kids that are failing. And then organizing the schedule so all the kids are really taught by that teacher. That would be classic instructional management. And it shocks me to say, as we've gone through this work, we've come to see both orientations as necessary. What we typically see is there's a strong emphasis on instruction improvement and curriculum instruction, and a strong emphasis on instructional management exclusively in leadership. The trick is how to coordinate that way, while ensuring you don't have to all the ambitious goals of students in academic development. Let's assume that folks in those two units are framing the challenge. Still important that they also work towards compatible goals for students' learning and for teachers' learning. In other words, they have a compatible view of what high quality math instruction is. And you can imagine what happens if you don't get a train break. They're assuming completely new changes. So you get the situation I described at the beginning, where the teachers are getting one emphasis, principles are going around communicating through different sorts of expectations, pushing on those teachers. Let's suppose we've got to the point we're actually on the same page with regard to what we're attempting to accomplish here as a district for our kids. We hope to drive. We think it's also important that units in those different strategies that go about designing and implementing strategies employ what we would term a learning perspective rather than a compliance perspective. Most of the work in reading policy and leadership has no position on explicitly compliance perspective. David Cohen, I think, did really well some years ago. He said, any time you're implementing a policy that requires people to do something different, you can focus on learning. And he went on to say, policy is a form of instruction. That's so the district leaders are the only ones that understand that, and they think about we've got to figure out how to support these learning, or is it about we've got to get these teachers, these principals to do what we want? Compliance. Oops. And a key indicator of whether we've seen that they take a perspective is do they recognize the people in the district who have expertise in math teaching and teacher learning? One of the chief academic officers we work with, his background is in social studies. He knows he doesn't have that any time we meet with him, he's got his math specialists in there. And half the time, he's asking them questions. Why? Because he's taking a learning perspective. These people know far more than he does about how to support teachers' learning. That's what the value of their experience. We've had another district, we're talking to the superintendent, who was even wondering why they had really hardcore compliance. So we have different sort of viewpoints. two things seem to be important. The role of senior district leaders, and here I'm talking about the superintendent or the chief academic officer, that sort of level. Instead of direction, now mercifully, they don't need to know much about the MAC instruction. I mentioned a fellow just now whose background is in social studies. He's a very good chief academic officer. Why? Because he's communicating what the role should be for students who are attending high. The text is moving. And he's indicating the emphasis on instruction, primarily on instruction improvement, as well as instruction management. So he's just setting the frame, and then he expects people from different units to collaborate to work together. And those relationships actually get worked out on the job. There's a clear expectation that the people from different units are going to collaborate, design, and implement improvement strategies and processes. So we sort of done the five items, verification so far, starting out the way down there. If we take a brief pause and step back, we've sort of given this overview of the current iteration of our theory of action. Notice that it involves designing and supporting the learning from members of a number of different worldviews. It's very complex. A lot has to go right, and much can go wrong. The review is comprehensive, but also incredibly provisional. I tried to wave my hand. I don't want to say quite what even we're on the risk, but understand these are conjectures still to be tested. We think all five components are necessary. The other sort of weasel words I put in would be things like if you happen to work in a district where there's a high proportion of accountant teachers, maybe you don't need accountant coaches because those teachers can become formal leaders who can support others. Basically, right now we see all five aspects as critical. Now then, well, Ken, do you want me to keep going? Or I can give a very quick overview of current work, or I can shut up and take questions. What would be most of that?
I think you need to go ahead and close as you would like to.
Okay, I'll try.
It's very quick. The group, 10 minutes. I feel guilty to control the ideas.
Well, I did.
I think it's not an exact question, so I want you to go to questions. So,
5 minutes. I can't do this from here. I don't think that. So, very brief then. We made the decision to continue to cover two of the districts, double the number of schools and teachers to get adequate power. And we wanted to do that to have a closer relationship. And skip some institutes. Just focus on one aspect of this, which is what the addition we've been doing is collaborating with district leaders to co-design, co-lead professional development for coaches and school leaders. Why do we want to do that? We are not PD providers. We don't want to be external service providers to districts. We're collaborators. And we want to investigate ways of supporting the development of district capacity. And we see that collaboration as a means of doing that. So in other words, the challenge is not just to design the PD, it's also to support the district's capacity to design and offer the good PD itself. That's what we mean by working in hand, if that's our focus. So very quickly, one of our districts, which we endearingly call District B, it's a district related to second commission. What happens? Teachers typically, this is in the aggregate, hope they do use high-level tasks, God bless them, but they don't maintain the challenge of those tasks throughout the lesson. More teachers have been conducting whole class discussions, far more, but they're at the show and tell throughout. In other words, group one gets up, group two gets up, there's no discussion, no press, to my point, very few learning. They hired three, just this last year, hired three district-based math coaches. And I share luck, all three of the participants in our study in other positions. So we have data on their practices in mathematical biology, teaching and so forth. And they hired pretty strong phenomenally high on the right hand, which they were all three accomplished math teachers. They are respected now, not many of them, but enough, working across 30 new great schools, and they're expected to be campus deans. So we decided to collaborate with district leaders to support the coaches in those district coaches in designing the professional teachers, but we wanted to collaborate with the district math specialists. So we saw that collaboration potential, that collaboration could be a context to support the learning of the district math specialists in designing PD for coaches and for school leaders. So I hope that makes some sense. So we're trying to work at two levels. We're trying to support coaches in designing and offering PD for teachers, and we're trying to support the district folks in designing and leading PD for coaches and for school leaders. You can guess that there are PDs organized around specific instruction practices. What are our goals for folks learning? Here I'm going to state it relatively broad. First, it builds on that idea of professional vision for coaching, a vision of professional learning that they approach. Professional learning as a trajectory for a progression rather than creating deficits. And I would just tell you in this district, there's been a history of, you know, the district leaders develop a set of PowerPoints, they go through them with the coaches expect to turn around the campus level. So this is, you know, quite a shift that we're aiming for here or trying for here. Obviously that requires a sophisticated vision of high quality math instruction and an educational trajectory. So that's the first aspect we're interested in. The second aspect is designing professional development, whether it's teachers or coaches. In the case of teachers, it's assessing teachers' current practice, or assessing teachers' current practices, formulating goals because you can situate them within a trajectory for their learning, identifying activities in which to engage them, and we would add identifying two or three ideas in which to press during the session. Why do we say that? We did view a number of PE sessions in this district. What we noticed was teachers were really happy. They get very good reviews. Is that not a problem? All teacher contributions are treated equally. In other words, there's no differential treatment, no press on particular ideas. So we're very skeptical about the extent to which that development and ambitious practices. And we've also answered that in time short. I just want to give a brief idea of how we set this up. We have this broad cycle that we would work with district leaders to co-plan upcoming sessions. We then go to the district, we and the district leaders to co-lead the professional development session for principals for 2 or 3 hours. The following day, we need a coordinated professional development session with the coaches, which would last 6 hours, typically happening for 6 hours. And the idea was to work with the principals and the coaches to focus on the same practices. The focus of the coach work was to design campus PD around an upcoming lesson in which teachers and students both struggle. They go off to pilot PD. An after-school session, which was videotaped, okay? And then, against that background, we designed the next set of sessions. So we went through this cycle 3 times last fall, and there was a planned handover to the district folks. We then consulted on the plan, but they led the sessions by themselves in one set area, one session in the spring. So this handover was planned. Specifically, the work with the coaches, so now my hours would be up to 4 hours on the ground. I guess the key point is when coaches need PD with pilot groups, and that's a video recording, we then watch and analyze those video recordings for 2 purposes. One, to analyze the extent of the coach's learning with respect to goals, its informative assessment to inform the next step. And also to identify clips to use in the next PD session. So nothing to go to. All I want to claim is we attempt to be pretty consistent with some of the core principles of professional development that I promote. What did we find? Overall, some encouragement, but a way to go. There was improvement in coaches and math specialists viewing professional learning as a developmental progression. However, they need further support. In other words, when things don't go as we expect, we assume we screwed up one more time and look at how we can improve our design. Need further support in identifying short, long-term goals for teachers' learning. Big improvement in terms of attempting to compress on teachers' ideas. However, they need further support in identifying the ideas. I think that's because we press against the background of what the goals are for folks' learning. What can we build on to achieve an agenda? And those goals were clear. I have to be teaching the mathematics course for future elementary teachers this semester, and I have the same phenomenon every time I do this. Folks want to skip beyond understanding the reason for that they have to do this. Well, you know, there's no. And this seems very earnest. The coaches want to skip over, let's understand the teachers, current teachers, current practices, the next steps of their learning, to what they do, what they do. So that's all. So we've got to figure out that tuning. Is this just a story about working with a very small number of coaches? Yes and no. It's a case of collaborating with district math leaders to co-design and again, I want to stress our overall goal is to support and investigate the development of district capacity. And this is sort of one of our steps or efforts to do so. Design experiment within a different project. I started out near the beginning by saying the problem scales the problem of organization as well as teacher learning. It indicates the learning of math coaches, school leaders, and district leaders. And I hope I've illustrated that. District leadership really matters. We can trace some of these things all the way down to the classroom. It also involves, what does organization involve beyond just learning a bunch of people? But it involves developing tools. Now, I haven't featured this in this presentation, but for example, classroom observation protocols, protocols for teacher collaborating classes. The tools don't do it. There has to be support around how to use these tools to adapt. It's also pretty critical. And it involves the development of organization. And I showed you one of those, school leadership. And if you're interested, we do have a website where you can download papers, adaptive feedback reports, if you happen to be interested in what those would map. Two of those are there, 2011 annual large school survey. You have been wonderful sports in putting up with all these times. Thank you very much.
Time for a few questions from Paul Cobb, or for Paul Cobb. Coaches never became significant, significant teachers.
two issues. How those folks apply it, they are identified by the principle that can be a criteria. Some of them are identified by the best teams, some say, oh, this person needs to work. It's actually a big criteria. So there's that position. The second thing is limited guidance on the research on if you identify people who are very strong in math teachers, on what good coaching you might be. So I think it's a very productive idea. And I think it's easier to identify the right people to figure out the conditions of support that you can be effective. And again, I would stress they also need support from the principal, you know that for sure. So it also has information to work with the principal. So it's not to push away or put your idea.
Hi, so I appreciate very much all of the theory and the principles that you provided for change. But one of the things that I didn't see, and it's probably in there somewhere, and you can help me find it, is the goal of developing that agency and leadership among the teachers so that when we're talking about what we need to do, we're talking, they're the ones doing the talking. So that there's more opportunity for teachers to participate in the national dialogue and to participate in the discourse about change. So that's
great. Yeah, thank you.
Paul, thank you. There are some important announcements before you take off. There are